Welcome to Random Thoughts, episode six.
Six, we made it that far. Wow.
I know, it's amazing. It's, you know, I was just thinking about this. I listen to a lot of podcasts between business, domain names, like Daily Fantasy, because I'm, as you know, I'm a pretty serious DraftKings Daily Fantasy player. I listen to podcasts for pleasure. There's an amazing podcast, Names and Games, for us Patriots fans. That's Julian Edelman's podcast that is extremely top 10 in the country. And last night I wanted to listen to the newest episode. And, man, this is like too many podcasts and not enough time.
I was about to say, where do you have time to do all this? Yeah.
I don't. And it's kind of thinking about, that's like why I kind of feel good about, you know, we're on episode six. It's pretty impressive. But also to, you know, do these when they're important. We have something really important to talk about and say versus just for random, because, man, listening to recording podcasts is hard. Getting the content, getting in this place to do a quality program that the audience likes, but listening to them, man, I can't get through everything I want to listen to. And that doesn't even include reading a book. I don't know the last time I read a book. Television shows, you know, you get in the car and you want to do phone calls and business calls and catch up with people you haven't spoken to. And there's not enough freaking time in the day, man. Not enough time in the day. So anyway, awesome to be back. You know, I always get excited when we have our little opening Nirvana music, but about a year ago, March of 23, a little over a year ago now, was when Larry and I together closed the chat.com sale, which I thought about today because about a half an hour ago, Larry texted me and said, "Did you see the news?" And I'm like, "No." And, you know, there is all kinds of crazy stock activity today around HubSpot and rumors about Google buying HubSpot, which has a $32 billion market cap. And as we know, Google has about $110 billion in free cash, so they need to do something with it. And there's HubSpot stock I saw was up about 60 points, $60. I think, you know, 15% on the day on the rumors. And of course, we sold chat.com to Dharma Shah, the founder and CTO and chairman of the board of HubSpot, about a year ago. And it got me thinking about this story to open today, because about a year ago, Larry, around February of 23, when we were working on chat.com, I said, Larry and I are both Bruce Springsteen hardcore fans. And we both have been to a lot of concerts. I've been to 103 Grateful Dead shows and Dead and Company shows. So that is certainly my number one love. But Springsteen isn't too far behind. And Larry is a, you know, diehard. So
I'm at 124.
Okay. So he's been more Springsteen shows than I've been to Dead. Pretty crazy. So, but, you know, when we started to talk about chat, I'm like, hey, if we get the deal done, I have my family is friends with Springsteen's management and family forever, my wife's family. So, you know, I've been going to shows long before I knew my wife, but, you know, my tickets have been upgraded significantly since I met my wife and that relationship. And
that was the main reason for marrying her, I guess, right?
No, clearly. She doesn't even go. So, I said to Larry, hey, you know, I got awesome Springsteen tickets to Boston Garden. And this was in March of 23. If we close the chat deal, you should come. So sure enough, we get like a week before the show and we're in pretty serious discussions to sell the domain name. You know, this was, again, our biggest transaction of all time. It was a big one. And Larry is back and forth between his permanent home in Brooklyn and his second new home in Florida. Brooklyn's a very easy trip to Boston. You know, you can get here any hour on the hour on multiple trains and planes and automobiles. Florida, a little more tricky. And on we're entering this day and suddenly the deal closes around noon, 11:30 a.m. the day of the show. I'm like, you're coming, right, Larry?
Oh,
and
yes.
He's like, I'm trying to get a flight. I'm like, what do you mean? You can get here and there's flights every hour. He goes, dude, I'm in Florida. I'm like, oh man. So long story short, Larry did not come.
Yeah.
Okay. So we then rain checked it. Let's celebrate it. On me for working together on the chat deal. Let's do it at Gillette Stadium in August 23. And then Larry said, great. But ultimately, he ended up being away in upstate New York with his family. So, alas, next Friday, we will finally celebrate this in a a very small venue, 10,000 seat Mohegan Sun Casino Arena in Connecticut. And I'm really excited about it. Daniel, my superstar guy who works with me here at Hilco, and a buddy of mine are going to drive up. We have a reservation at Tao to get some drinks and dinner beforehand. And, you know, we'll be able to see the show. But in honor of that, Larry, I asked Lawrence to pull up a quick little clip from Boston Garden, March of 23, in celebration of our anniversary of the chat doc. kept it short enough that I think we won't have any rights issues. But Lawrence, if you could cue up Boston Garden, March 23 for us. So we'll get you a little pumped up, Larry. I was asking you before we came on here. So, you know, let's kind of keep this brief, but sure. What is your 124 shows? What is your, I have a favorite Dead show of 104 or three.
You know, there's so many particular shows and reasons why I could pick at least 20 shows. You know, when he came back 5 years later, when he came back in 2015, you know, you weren't expecting it and it picked up. And it's a different concert now than it was back then. But the very first show I went to, I have to say, was the most special because I wasn't expecting it. I knew nothing of Bruce Springsteen. I was at my college in downtown New York. It was noon. We were sitting in the pub because it just opened. You were allowed to drink back then at school. And one of my buddies came up and said, "Hey, what are you doing this weekend?" I go, "Nothing. You want to go see Springsteen in Buffalo?" I said, "Sure." It was that night. It was, so we had a 7-hour ride. So I basically just got in a car with him and we went to the Oud and slept on. And I remember going there, going to show, sleeping in one of the campus's lounges. And it was but the show itself, I'd never seen anything like it before. It was mind-blowing. And to see him at his
prime. By the way, Daniel, this will be Daniel's first experience that we're at Mohegan Sun. So he, many years later, but he may experience some of that.
Oh, that's great. It's sort of like, you know, I've never done heroin, but they say the first time is you get that rush and you keep going back because you want to feel it, but you never get the same thing. Yeah, Bruce is my heroin, man.
And, you know, Dead Show is very similar. The Grateful Dead shows were, you know, my first Dead Show, you know, is, I could talk all day about that. But I've also seen to about 45 Springsteen shows and, you know, starting my first one in high school and I'm old. So, you know, he was a young guy. It was a very different time. But, you know, even at 74, you know, the energy is the same. And it should be an exciting night. And
one thing I want to add, if anybody is into seeing Bruce, I know that he came out with an album years ago that had a video from a December or November 1980-81 show. If you want to see the excitement, it was generated in that tape. Excellent. That really
made that show. Era was something else too, right? That was a crazy time, probably like the River Tour or something. And by the way, you know, Buffalo's, experienced a lot in Buffalo. I had a college roommate who grew up in Buffalo, and so I've been to Patriots and Bills games, multiple Bruins, Sabres games on the hockey side, multiple Grateful Dead shows, both indoors and outdoors in Buffalo. And you know, you get some good wings,
right?
It's wholesome. The audience is into it. It's all good. So anyway, you know, look, we're celebrating a deal that was over a year ago when we're working on, both together and separately, on some pretty significant new ones that we'll obviously hopefully be able to celebrate soon, because, you know, we're going to put the closure on chat.com here next week when we go to Bruce, and then we're going to focus on our next 8-figure deal that we can celebrate. A year is a long time. So speaking of which, I have recently posted in my Random Sunday Thoughts column on LinkedIn that the first quarter of 2024, which is just a week old now, ended a week ago, was one of the most memorable windows of time in my 26 years in domains for many reasons. First, on our end, we oversaw at Hilco Digital a combined $31 million of domain transactions. And
congrats, man. Congrats. That's big. I mean,
just crazy, right? Crazy numbers and for our industry. And while I cannot, due to confidentiality agreements and NDAs, which are pretty strict, discuss all of them at least yet, by the overall number, we can assume or deduce that the dollar size of some of these deals were amongst the top domain transactions of all time, like chat.com was a year ago. And what I can discuss a bit is gold.com, because it was announced the Monday after the acquisition by the buyer. The buyer was a public company called, well, A-Mark Precious Metals and their subsidiary, JM Bullion. And gold.com was one of the most complex deals I have ever worked on, as it involved some really complicated agreements, both from a business deal, negotiation, and contract standpoint. And, you know, this started a year, Larry, before it closed. And in that year, everything from the price was negotiated, as well as a lot of complexities. This deal is the reason that, and I've said this before, and I know people make fun of me for this, but I use the term consultant or advisor in my agreements and not broker, because this was so much more than just the sale of a domain name. This involved advanced negotiations with multiple parties, some which are extremely large companies, both the business and the legal side. Right. And I will say, you know, just say we earned our money, but I was so satisfied with it at the end. It may be the most satisfying, not the biggest, most satisfying deal of my entire lifetime because of what it took from beginning to end to get through it. And, you know, I know, Larry, you've been obviously involved in so many too. Have you had any, you know, deals that you would consider like challenging
sometimes you feel they're all challenging, but one of the most interesting I ever had was when we bought home.com for the first time. And it was the first, I think it was one of the first seven-figure deals that I was in. And it was dealing with finding, first you have to find, you know, like everything. You have to find out who the correct owner is. And then once you find it, you have to find the right party and the right groups. And we got that. The challenge, the major challenge we had was the people we had to deal with spoke Japanese. And we had to deal through interpreters. We had to deal with different customs. We had to, you know, it even took a flight over there. So it's one of those things that in the end, you know, while you're going through it, you know, in the back of your mind, it's never going to happen. You know, there's too much complexity. There's too much craziness going on. The contracts too had to be, you know, ironed out, and especially since they're going back from Japanese and English. But in the end, when that closed, it was probably one of the most satisfying feelings. And I remember a number of people coming up to me, because a lot of people have alerts when domains change hands. And someone, I remember one of the shows, we had just closed it that morning, and about the next day when the who has changed, they came up to me. I've been trying to get this for X number of years, he says to me, and one of the major domains. And then I keep getting it from other people. And how'd you do it? And I go, realistically, I worked up a nice relationship with the person, and we gained the trust of each other that he felt that we were sincere and honest, and which we were. And it led to then, you know, owning it and waiting for that and making a proper offer happen. And we ended up getting that together, which was another eight-figure deal of ours. So
yeah, you know, I guess we could celebrate the Springsteen show could be the celebration of two eight-figure deals, home.com in 22 and gold.com in 23.
Right. And I feel, and we can't announce what, but I really feel we'll have another eight-figure deal this year. So
yeah, we Larry and I are working on a pretty big opportunity together that we have very exciting prospects for, so that will be good. And by the way, talking about, you know, your story with home.com, my client who I sold gold.com for is a great guy, but in China, and you know, speaks, you know, great written English, but you know, not as easily spoken English. And you know, we had to navigate a pretty complex deal, and I had to make sure he understood it. explained it to him. And, you know, and it was complex for reasons someday I'll hopefully be able to discuss. I can't really get into all the reasons now, but, you know, this was, it was, I will say that it was a pleasure, you know, the buyer and the, everyone in the, even though it was complex, all the parties involved, and that was me, the seller, the buyer, and a third party that was a big company. Everybody was actually a pleasure and amazing to deal with. And that is one of the reasons why it happened, and it happened the way it happened. And, you know, so even though it was complex, it wasn't because I was dealing with difficult parties. It was quite the opposite. It just had some intricacies to it that made it complicated. And I'm hoping that on one of our random thoughts here in the next few episodes, we'll be able to bring on the buyer, CEO and president of the buyer. They'll talk a lot about why they bought it and where they're going with it as a case study and as a guest. He's told me that he absolutely will come on, but he wants to wait until they've kind of fully, you know, went forward with their strategy that is underway of why they bought the domain.
Right.
So that will be great. And, you know, on the heels of Gold in March, we at Hilco oversaw what ended up an even more complicated negotiation on one of the three most significant domain transactions I've been involved with. Two of them were with Larry, so this one wasn't. We talked about what they were. And the deal closed in the first quarter, but due to some of the complexities, it will not be fully baked until September. It's a done deal, but there are, you know, reasons why it will not be fully transferred until September. Then at that point, I hope to be able to use it again as a case study to provide some wisdom on some of the things that need to happen to get high level deals done, because it's really important, right? The point is, these deals often take time, patience, quite frankly, navigating a ship, sometimes in a dark sea, right? Sometimes these deals or buyers die. And we talked a lot about the home.com deal, Larry and I, in prior podcasts and in NamesCon, about how December of 2021, you know, the deal pretty much was dead and resuscitated in January and closed a few weeks later. So sometimes they die and come back to life. If I do my job well, right? Part of that is for Larry, me, and other people who are handling domain acquisitions at a high level or sales to do their job to make sure that some of these potential deals that might have hit a road bump or have to require a little more patience to actually still happen. I recently closed a really awesome win for my good friend and Larry's friend, James Booth, and what will be a really awesome win-win transaction that we will be able to at least not say the buyer or the price, but what the domain was in I would say by my Sunday thoughts on Sunday, hopefully, on the line. And I have a couple more going in late stages. And, you know, in 2023, I said often that we were really in a challenging time, especially with the deployment of venture capital money. And venture capital money, startups, the startup ecosystem, venture funding is so important for liquidity in domains, because you need new companies and growing companies to that are, you know, growing in online businesses to have brands that or categories that match a domain name. And while it is still slower than perfect, it is absolutely improving, as reflected in how we have started 2024 in the first quarter. Do you agree with that, Larry? Are you saying
without a doubt? I mean, towards the end of last year into this year, definitely seeing the growth. And I also agree that, you know, a lot of these companies that are coming forward and realizing the necessity for them to get the generic name for their category is huge. We did a deal last year, well, the end of last year into the beginning of this year, for design.com. And
great name.
I loved it. I think it's one of the best names.
Category and brand, right?
Name. And we, you know, you have to work with the buyers too. I mean, if you have a buyer that you know is the right buyer, they want it, we want to sell it, and the price is the only issue, you try and figure out a way that they can make that price or come close to it. And what a lot of people don't realize is there are a lot of sellers that will work with you, will do payments over time, perhaps, or possibly, you know, this particular deal they had some provisions where they were going to get money in a few months, and they didn't want to lose the deal. So we worked out an arrangement, they did it, and then they even paid off early to get the whole name because they wanted to control it because they realized how important that name is. And there's more and more
companies like that. One of the things we're going to do, in this episode, as we did last episode, and I'm doing a little bit on my Sunday thoughts every week, is kind of share some insights into how these kind of big deals get done. So I know people have, the response has been awesome for that. So we're trying to kind of give back a little bit and share that. But, one of the barometers for me is, we recently became partners and own HilcoVentureCapital.com. And we have a website that is now one of the leaders in providing venture capital and finance and tech news every day in real time at VentureCapital.com. And, yesterday, my partner, Laura, who handles the human editing side. So we generate a lot of the content with AI, but every single story is human touched, human edited, checked for facts. She said she published 70 stories yesterday. So to me, that means there were 70 stories, let's say over the last 24 hours, or, I guess it was a Monday? It's now Tuesday. So Wednesday. So over the last few days, there were, 70 stories about venture funding, venture rounds, venture news. And that is a huge uptick. That is a huge uptick in the space. And that to me is a gauge. If we're publishing 10 stories and 30 and then 70, that means there's more deals happening, which is great. Right. So I actually have a funny story, which is I also posted this recently. So there is a domain name that we have yet to sell, but we're representing. The domain is trivia.com. Okay. Also a brand and a category name. And last month, Tuesday, I believe, or Wednesday, I started to get a couple of emails from random consumers, random people out there about trivia.com.
Right.
And I read them and I'm like, this is odd, but whatever happens. Well, by the end of that day, I had over 100 emails from people contacting me at the trivia.com email address, which comes to me. And, or from the land, if you go to trivia.com, there's an email address that gets forwarded to me. And I decided I better reply back to some of these people and figure out what's going on. I was curious. And what I learned very quickly was Alex Levine, I believe his name is, who is one of the all-time greatest champions on the television show Jeopardy. Mm-hmm. And there was a Tournament of Champions show that aired that Tuesday, that night, on TV, national TV on Jeopardy. And Alex was on the show as one of the Tournament of Champions contestants. And on the show, he promoted or is given the opportunity, maybe because part of his agreement to come back on, a subscription or e-commerce product that he's selling called School of Trivia that he is selling to people to help them get ready and prepare for trivia games or shows like Jeopardy. Pretty cool. Pretty cool product. Yeah. And he must, I went back and I watched the clip of the episode and he said, schooloftrivia.com. schooloftrivia.com. That's his URL. And what happened is everybody on TV listening just ignored the School of, and they just went to trivia.com. Right. And that's why I got 100 emails. And by the way, another 100 since. So 200 emails from this airing at Jeopardy when trivia.com wasn't what's mentioned. Schooloftrivia.com was, but people just jumped to the assumed trivia.com. Assumed. And that kind of is a huge point that I always speak to potential end users, especially exact match one of a domain, right? Whether it's Hello Public became public.com, a case study we've talked about a lot recently, or it's a .io or a .ai or a different TLD, history has shown over and over again that if you're on national TV and you do a $30 million Super Bowl ad and you say trivia.io, 80 to 90, if not 100% of those people are just going to assume it's .com.
Right.
Your Hello Trivia or School of Trivia, that also may happen because the equivalent of a Super Bowl commercial is being on Jeopardy, right, on a Tuesday night on national TV. Right. So, what I always say is if you're an owner of a company that's using a secondary TLD to start off, .io.ai.us, if you are a company that was called Hello Public or Hello Extend, and like those two companies, decided they needed to be narrowed down to their exact match product, extend.com or public.com, and you are going to take a risk that a variety of things are going to happen. Number one, you spend money on marketing, advertising, word of mouth, everything, social media, something goes viral, and just like a Super Bowl ad, a television campaign, and just like happened on Jeopardy, you're going to lose a majority of your customers who just go to the exactmatch.com or .com itself versus the secondary TLD. And secondly, I can't tell you, and Larry, I'm sure you noticed too, how many domains that we own or represent that's in a single word, one word .com, and we receive, we have a catch-all email box set up. So that means anyone that sends any email to that domain name, anything at trivia.com comes into that catch-all email. I can tell you we have more than 30 or 40 domains where there are large companies that are not using it, but they're using something similar, like, again, either a .io or a different TLD. We get 30, 40 emails a week, a month. Some of them clearly confidential. Some of them from their own internal management people that just type by inherent habit the .com. And if you're in a management of a company that you're not using your exact match .domain, your .com, can you risk that? And my opinion is the answer is unequivocally no. And this is a story that shows that, right?
Right, yeah. And it brings us to the question about all these GTLDs and country codes. And, you know, there's a flavor of the week or a flavor of the month. I mean, we've had it where .mobi was big. Then it was .xyz. And the prices of these things, you know, start, you know, people, investors jumped in on that. I mean, now it's .ai, which there are, you know, uses for. However, I see that as just eventually being more of the same, where people are going to eventually, you know, it's always comes back to .com. And I think it makes .com stronger each and every time.
Yeah. By the way, I reached out to Alex after all this and was like, hey, I want to let you know this happened. And he's like, can you forward me the emails? I'm like, you want me to forward you 200 emails from consumers? I don't know if I have the time to do that, but I'd love to talk to you. Maybe there's something to be done right here with this product. It's pretty cool. So, you know, it was interesting how these things evolve. But, you know, just it was it didn't take me very long to figure it out. And I kind of put my team on it. But just an amazing real world example that I like to share because I think it's pretty powerful. So, last episode and a few minutes ago, you know, I promised we would also continue to provide some giving back insight and expertise into what I'd say the inner workings of these type of very high level category defining or one word domain transactions. And, you know, we spoke a lot about the ZOPA, I think, in the last one, which is the zone of a possible agreement and how important that is. And we'll touch on that again a little bit because that kind of plays into everything. Just to re-explain what that is, you know, it is really important. And I make sure anyone that we represent has a zone of possible agreement. So maybe in their head, they want $5 million for the domain name. Okay. And that's great. And maybe we'll get 7 million, but let's say there's a really good offer for 3.5. We have to have a zone of a possible agreement so we can, because a really good deal is achieved when both sides feel like they've won, right? Not one side. And in order for both sides to feel like they win, it's usually going to happen in the middle, somewhere between my hands, in the middle of that zone. So, you know, I think that I was thinking about this. It is really important if you're a domain owner of one of these kind of really valuable domains that we deal with. Yeah, it's important you understand kind of how these deals get done at this level. And I don't think I'm surprised at how many people I work with didn't really understand it until we've worked together. And for category name defining names such as gold, chat.com, home.com, football.com, chocolate.com, public.com. Yep. It really requires a buyer who either already knows what they want to do with that asset, okay, right, or a buyer who wants to rebrand from hellopublic to public.com, or a completely different name to iconic.com or whatever, right, that domain is, or rebrand or establish a new brand. It could be a new company that hasn't picked their brand yet, or a venture cap company that is looking for a brand. We deal with this all the time, and they're looking for one word, powerful, you know, memorable, authoritative domain names. And that could take time. Brand exercises can take months. Rebrands can cost, you know, I'm involved with a company very closely that we're in the middle of a rebrand to a powerful one word, four-letter.com that will be announced in the next couple of weeks. And I'm excited for that. And we'll definitely talk more about it when it is. But, you know, it's a 2-month, $500 million rebrand process before we're ready to announce it. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes we get lucky and it's like weeks, right, to get a deal done. Chat.com, I think, Larry, what, 9 weeks or something like that?
Beginning a little less even, I think.
Yeah, maybe less. Yeah. Home.com was over, you know, much, much longer, right? Sometimes it takes years, guys, or ladies and gentlemen, or people, years. And for the most valuable internet real estate, and I want to stress this point, there may, in my humble opinion, there may only be one, if you're lucky, two, and if you're shitty, shit-ass lucky, three, one, two, max three buyers in any given window of time. And what is a window of time? 1 month to 3 years. In a one, you know, from today to 3 years out, you may, there may be one buyer who, when I say buyer for that domain, who is, knows that they want it, knows why they want it, and is willing to pay the price that we're asking for it, right? All three criteria. There may be buyers who want it but don't want to pay the price. There may be buyers who don't know what they're going to do with it, so they're not ready to buy it. But I am talking about, you know, in a given window of time, in a big ocean, right? The internet is a big ocean. There's 477,000 single words in the Webster's Dictionary, okay? That's a lot of potential domain names. There may be one or two or three buyers. And from my standpoint, Larry and me and people who do what we do, our job is to cast a wide enough net, find that one, maybe if you're lucky too, because then it can be a bidding war like chat.com, yeah, right? One or two buyers, and then help make sure you can, we navigate the negotiation process, you know, to get them over, you know, over the hump. You have to understand, they have to understand the value and how that investment will allow them to achieve game-changing enterprise value. And you have, they have to understand and be prepared to spend the dollars required to acquire that asset, right? Mm-hmm. There are the category domains for exact match domains, right? Brandable domains, not legal or football or chocolate, but iconic or public or extend, I suppose, right? That's even a narrower audience, right? Mm-hmm. Because that requires either an established company that already has that word in their brand name, like Hello Public, like Hello Extend, or somebody using a secondary TLD like iconic.io, and they want to now upgrade to their .com, which they do and should do. So a secondary TLD will not get them to the next level. But a company that's looking to rebrand to the exact match, or a founder or investor looking for a new name, mm-hmm, there's only probably one category.com, and there's always a choice for these people on the brand or rebrand. People have to understand, you know, that's why the ZOPA, the Zone of Possible Agreement, becomes so important to getting these deals done, especially in a less than stellar economic or venture environment or climate. Because if you're saying, I want $5 million for this domain name, mm-hmm, and they have a second choice of a brand, maybe they want to buy, you know, one word is 5 million, and they can buy another one for $850,000. You know, that's a big gap, and they may very well go with the other one. And if you don't have that zone of agreement, you know, you could lose that one buyer who wanted that domain, who already knew they wanted it, and mm-hmm, it may take you years to find the replacement. Years. What do you think, Larry? I mean,
about what you just said at the end. One of the things that happens a lot of times is somebody gets an offer quick, and the offer could be that 850 when they were looking for 2 million. And you have to really get into that zone and discuss it with them, because I think sometimes people, if something comes too early, they think that, oh, it must be worth more than I'm even thinking. So you have to realize if it is in that zone, you know, consider it and try and realize the outcome. I mean, that's what we did with Chat. In Chat, it was in the zone. So, I mean, I have a feeling that if we would have pushed higher, you know, it may not have happened. So it was worth it. Both buyer and seller were happy. And, you know,
everybody felt they were getting a win. And, you know, it's like the old Wall, you know, I started on Wall Street at, you know, multiple investment banking firms and working for Michael Milken and Drexel Burnham. And, you know, as the movie is a line you'll see in many movies, you know, and it's the one of the biggest cliches of all time. But, you know, bulls make money, bears make money, and pigs get slaughtered. Mm-hmm. And when you're, that's with stocks, right? That's like, you don't need to sell a stock at the absolute high or buy it at the absolute low to do very well. But with domains, it's even more so, because if we, working with you, get that one, maybe two potential parties who know they're ready to move on the hook, and they're biting that bait, mm-hmm. and we don't have a Zopa and we lose that deal, now you're fishing in a big sea and you're not looking for someone else who realizes already that this is a domain they want, right? It is very hard. And then this is the last piece I would say. I can't, right. I don't want to say the company and I don't want to say the domain name out of respect for the CEO, but mm-hmm. I am overseeing the sale of an amazing category domain name, one of the best in the world, okay? And I know the CEO of one of the largest companies, a multi-billion dollar public company in the world that has multiple brands in this category. Mm-hmm. And when I first approached him about the domain name, and we have a relationship, he said, man, I love the domain name. How could I not? But I would only buy this if I had buy-in across my marketing team, my packaging team, my tech team, my advertising team, that we were going to have a strategy and use it that cuts across all of those different departments. Right. I'm not going to buy it to put, I'm not going to spend eight figures to put it up on my shelf or buy it defensively or just buy it because it feels good. He goes, we didn't become a multi-billion dollar company by throwing money out without a reason. We need the strategy. And quite frankly, I've run it by my different departments. And right now, we don't have that. I think we might someday, but right now we don't have that. And therefore, we're not a buyer right now, right? So if you happen to get that buyer that does have that strategy and you blow the deal because you're greedy or you know, and I work very hard to make sure I have a zone of possible agreement with my clients and people I work mm-hmm. with, because I don't want to let them mess up a deal. Okay. And I think it's so important that you have that. So I did want to, just because I can't contain my own excitement, we started with Bruce Springsteen, and we are now on the cusp of the Masters, which as many of you who follow me know, I'm a huge DraftKings player, kind of one step below professional and one step above amateur, but a serious player. And I play a lot of DraftKings golf, and the Masters is like the Super Bowl for golf, for DraftKings. And, you know, I had to touch on it for a minute before we make one kind of cool announcement for Larry and I at the end. So stay tuned for this announcement, even if you're not a golf fan. This will be quick. But, you know, if you don't follow golf, what's going on right now is Scottie Scheffler is the best golfer in the world. And when I say there's nobody even in the same stratosphere, what he is doing statistically, what we call in golf strokes gained on approach, is epic levels. And to put that in perspective, he is 4-1 to win the Masters. The next best golfer, Rory McIlroy, or the next highest odds is 10-1. He is $2,000 salary on DraftKings more than the next best golfer or the next highest priced golfer, which is Rory McIlroy. And it's interesting. Scottie won the Masters in 2022. He was 10th last year. He was 18th and 19th in the year before that. So four top 20s, but only one win and three outside the top 10. So that is 3 years he was not in the top 10. So there is a window for other people. And of every PGA event and major, course history matters more at Augusta than anywhere. It means the window is open for Jon Rahm, at half the ownership and much better odds, or Hideki Matsuyama, who was my sleeper pick, or young guy Sahith Fegala. So I cannot wait for the Masters. I can actually post my picks on Random Sunday Thoughts on Sunday. But
I have a question. I have a question. Do you just pick on the winner, or do you pick on different stats along the way when you're betting?
For DraftKings, you need six golfers in your pool to succeed in your player pool. For betting, you can bet on any single one golfer. I'll be doing a little bit of both for the Masters.
So they'll be going off stats and comparing what's in your
stats. History stats. You know, the only reason I wanted to bring this up, other than I'm excited for it, is, you know, Scottie Scheffler, what he's doing, as I said, is so epic. And like Tiger Woods before him, and like, let's say, Larry Bird or other, you know, Magic Johnson in the NBA, you know, the amount of it's a known the amount of time that Scottie is investing in the game of golf, the amount of putts he hits every practice round and every day. He's on the driving range first in the morning and last at the night. They're pulling him off, even if he's got a bad neck, which he had last week. And, you know, it just goes to show, whether it's golf or domain name investing or domain name selling and acquiring, you know, input equals output. It really does.
Oh, without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Input equals output. And if you are, you know, we are relentless. If we decide to, you know, and Larry is the same way, if we decide to take on a domain name, you know, we only work with the absolute highest and most valuable oneword.coms. And I know, you know, Drew's the same way at Media Options. If we decide to take on a domain name, we're all in. Like, we're Scottie Scheffler-ing it, right? We're hitting 100 putts and 150 drives until we get a win and cross the finish line, whether that takes a week, 9 weeks, or 5 years, hopefully.
I would say back in 2007, there was an article in the AP, and went on like, I guess, 500 papers. And it was between myself and Ari Goldberger, who was my partner on Smart Name and some other ventures. And in that article, because they, you know, the guy was at a domain auction, couldn't believe what we were doing and got really excited about it. He asked Ari to describe me. And I think it's just funny because Ari said, Larry is a rhinoceros. And I'm like, what does that mean? And
he already see that.
He goes, a rhinoceros chooses its prey. The prey runs up the tree, and the rhinoceros just sits there because eventually it has to come down. So I agree with you. You have to keep going. So I love that, sorry to interrupt you on that. Yeah.
I love the analogy. It's awesome. It's so true. I didn't know rhinoceros. I didn't know that's how rhino. I know rhinos and hippos are like underrated, deadly. But I didn't know that both. But I didn't know that's how they work. So here's what I'm most excited about. I've always promised that we would never exceed 1 hour. And that's when we're doing this live with Collins. Just to back up, today we decided to do this as a pre-recorded podcast with no Collins because we really wanted to cover some of this kind of tidbit stuff. But 44 minutes and 33 seconds, we usually leave 15 minutes for viewers to call in when we do it live. So we have 20 seconds to wrap. I want to end by saying I'm really excited because on NamesCon, which is in early June, once again, I will be in doing the keynote opening address. And I am so excited because Larry joined me last year and Larry's going to join me again. But so is Drew Rosner, my good buddy and our good buddy from Media Options. And, you know, like Larry and I, one of the OGs with the strongest track records in the history of this business. So we're going to get three of us up there on stage and it's going to be pretty epic. And it's going to be called Striking Gold with Domains, the Art of the Large Deal. That's the name of the session. So I am pretty pumped for it. Well, hopefully if you're watching this, we'll see you at NamesCon. Well, I'm sure it will be available after on demand as it always is on video. And Larry, excited to see you a week from Friday in Mohegan Sun for some drinks and Chinese food and what I expect to be an epic show because 10,000 seat arena, man. That I'm
looking forward to it.
I don't know about you, but I don't recall. I mean, I've seen Bruce on Broadway in a very small arena, but that's just Bruce on stage.
I've seen Bruce in a number of small shows in Jersey.
With the East Street Christmas band, though?
No, he did. Well, one, yes, but most of them were Christmas shows that I saw. One was.
Yeah, 10,000 seats is the smallest show I will ever see Bruce at with the full band, with the E Street band. So,
well, I've seen what Bruce used to do before he went on tour, he did two tours in Asbury Park at the convention center. And if you're lucky enough to get those, and I think I went to three of those. And
that's awesome. Never been.
It's just a few thousand people.
I think those days are behind us too.
Oh, without a doubt.
Anyway, it was. I hope everybody gets something out of this one, and look forward to our next episode. And I'm excited to see you in Connecticut. I really wish it wasn't Connecticut, but it'll be fun at the casino. I'm excited to see you Friday night, the week from Friday.
See you, my friend. Take care. Take care, all.